Campus Party, muy bien. Bienvenidos todos. Mi nombre es Carlos Quirarte. Soy el Country Head de EPAM Systems en México. Es nuestro primer año en Campus Party. Y el día de hoy traemos a nuestro CTO, Eli Feldman. Así que la presentación va a ser en inglés. Estoy asumiendo que todos aquí hablan inglés y si no, por lo menos lo entienden. Al final de la presentación va a haber una sesión de preguntas y respuestas. Así que siéntanse libre de hacerle cualquier pregunta que quieran a Eli. Su presentación va con respecto al tema de Step into the Future. Así que, bienvenidos, disfruten la presentación. Y se pueden acercar a nuestro stand para cualquier pregunta que tengan relacionada con EPAM Systems. ¿Qué es lo que estamos haciendo? ¿A qué nos dedicamos? ¿Qué tipo de clientes tenemos? ¿Qué oportunidades tenemos? ¿Y por qué somos tan buenos en lo que hacemos? ¿Ok? Muy bien, pues muchas gracias. Y nos vemos pronto. Bye.
Thanks, Carlos. Hey. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for joining. I have no idea what Carlos just said, so I hope it wasn't anything bad. Anyway, before we start, this is an awesome event. I mean, I really like what I see here. Thanks to the organizers. Let's put our hands together for the organizers for putting this together, and thanks for the invitation to speak here. Thanks for joining. Kudos and like respect to all the guys that are working there at the hackathons and like creating stuff.
This was really cool. Really quick technology.
Okay. Very quick about myself. Passionate about technology since the high school. Have been at this for quite a few years. Worked on wide variety of systems from like country level mission critical systems to semantic to distributed systems to cloud. Have been building the cloud practice at EPAM over the last 6 years and more recently responsible for overall technology in our organization, specifically focusing on innovation on where we do all of the R&D and development in EPAM, as well as the advanced technology practice, which is a core of our offering. About EPAM, so you probably have not heard about us much, although we are here now in Guadalajara for about a year. Actually, the anniversary is somewhere in July, somewhere July 16th or something like that. But we are a big global services company focusing specifically on product engineering. Number of verticals that we're focused on is financial services, media and entertainment. We have started our journey 23 years ago, focusing specifically on the software companies. So first 10 years, the only thing we were doing is professional software development for software companies, and almost all of the largest ISVs out there, the top five at least, have been clients of ours over the years. Some of them are clients continuously for 20 plus years at this point. We are global. We are on four continents, 25 countries, 17,000 engineers, designers, and consultants, and about 20,000 people in total in the organization. Focusing specifically in terms of business on North America and Western Europe, as well as a little bit of APAC and other areas. As I mentioned, about 80% of our portfolio in terms of business is product engineering. We do very little in terms of maintenance and support type work, less than 10% of the business overall. The rest of it is product engineering. So I'll start with a couple of basics and yell if you don't like it. Or like you want me to skip it all together, but I just wanted to give you a context of where I'm going with this in general. So one thing that I want to mention from the very beginning is that, and our friends here from Intel and from other companies are responsible to some degree to that, we have seen escalating capacity in terms of compute capacity, in terms of capability of computers overall over the last 6 to 7 decades. Specifically, over the last two, there was an explosion. And that explosion, and I'll explain that a little bit later in the presentation, is directly responsible for some of the major changes, major trends that are happening overall in the technology industry. You can see that in terms of numbers, we have gone from a compute capacity perspective, from maybe megaflops per $1 trillion pretty much, or $10 trillion originally, to cents on gigaflop. And same with storage, and same with other areas in compute. This is, again, giving you a little bit of context where I will be going with the presentation. And again, you might have seen this slide before. We are moving toward technological singularity at some point, and arguable at what point that will actually happen. This is driven by the increasing ability of computers to almost think for themselves. And again, I'll go a little bit into details about the work that we're doing in that space. We are, at this point, somewhere close to simulating on computers the mind of some of the simple creatures that we have on our planet. And within the 20 year or so, we should be able to get to being able to simulate the mind of a person. As you see from the evolution perspective, it took from the monkey to the person, it took about 50 million years of evolution. In terms of computers, it's taking decades. And you can only expect increasing performance there. And once we get to that theoretical singularity where computers can start figuring out for themselves how to improve themselves, that pace will escalate even further. So some of the stuff that is driven by that technology evolution, by the compute evolution, is ability of technology to be much closer to us. And you might be working on some of these projects yourselves. But ability to, I mean, at this point, we still cannot have a conversation with a computer, but we're actually not that far away. I mean, computers already understand gestures. They understand voice, obviously. I mean, all of us saw applications of that, quite a few on our phones or whatever that is. We increasingly find technology making decisions for us. And thermostats is a simple example of that. And we increasingly see that progressing where more and more computers will be able to understand us better, have a conversation with us, give us proper feedback, and apply that to some of the areas in the enterprise and in the social life as well. One of the things that it's creating overall, that evolution that is being done, is the fidelity of experience. So we all come to expect super cool, super nice interfaces from everything pretty much, right? From the most rudimentary fundamental things, I mentioned thermostat before, right? I mean, what can be simpler than a thermostat? But you expect that fidelity of experience from that thermostat. You obviously, Apple taught us how to create great experiences on a smartphone, and quite a few companies followed. We are seeing increasing mobility first applications in the enterprise over the years, and we see now that clients expect that experience to be very close to them, understand them, mimic what they expect from the experience overall. So much so that some of the voices in the industry at this point have been saying, actually for several years at this point, that experience is defining the brand, the software is defining the brand, primarily from the experience perspective. That's how companies perceive the brand, the companies that delivering that experience to the clients, and they increasingly so focus to make sure that clients are very much attached to that experience. Knowledge kills, specifically when you don't have it, and it's increasingly applied to the enterprise. This was cool back there. So it's increasingly applied to the enterprise. Companies need to clearly evolve their analytical capabilities. Next slide, please. clear level of their analytical capabilities, and this is all of the talks about big data and whatever that is, and I'm not going to go into definitions, definitely. But its ability to take all of the knowledge that are happening around an application, around a person, around an enterprise, in being able in a structured way to create prescriptive, predictive analytics where businesses can evolve themselves. And at some point, and I'll touch on that also a little bit later, at some point we should expect, and some companies making great strides in that direction already, a state where companies become increasingly automated in terms of their decision making and increasingly relying on real-time, very practical insights and applications of the data into their business overall. So, and this is some of the things, I mean, you have seen there's even a stage here for Internet of Things, and we have seen specific new technology. We have seen specific evolution in terms of the connected world. And again, some of the experience you see there. And we are being more and more connected on many different levels, actually. Connectivity in terms of the industrial side has been there for quite a while. The conversation about cyber physical in that sense, where heavy industries, manufacturing and all of that, producing increasing amount of data, and the data is used to create insights and create actions from that data. We have seen increasing application, and I mean, you have might have experienced that already here as well, in terms of the consumer side of IoT, anything that has to do with wearables, obviously. I'm sure quite few of you wear some of that. Connected cars, cars that drive themselves, make decisions for us. Over the next decade or so, maybe a little bit more, we will get into a stage where people themselves become connected on many different levels. So whether it's nanotechnologies that fight diseases inside the human, or further on, maybe 25 years from now, nanotechnologies that actually connect to the brain and person being able to connect themselves through sort of through cyber physical experience where a person can connect to the physical world with his mind. There's quite a few challenges, obviously, that are involved with that, both from a social perspective, from socioeconomic perspective, and we're seeing increasingly over the last couple of years that space evolving very rapidly and making sure that we can actually achieve all of the connected space at some point in the very near future. I wanted to sort of stay away a little bit from Internet of Things definition and connect a little bit more to Internet of everything and everyone. Some of the public information out there, I mean, quite a few people talking about it. There's increasing importance of connectivity for the enterprise, so much so that a number of companies are betting their hats on Internet of Things. There are a number of technology companies that, in fact, changing their entire portfolio of applications to evolve toward the connected space. And all of the different things that have happened before, from mobility, connectivity, cloud, analytics, big data, and related, are very much contributing into that space. The way we see it is that evolution, that contribution that are happening from overall of all of the strands that have been changing the industry, the technology industry over the last decade or so. I mean, cloud, mobility, it's about, what, 9-10 years or so, right? As well as customer experience, fidelity that I mentioned before, making sure that we have democratization of technology across the board, shift to open source in many different industries, making sure that engineering evolves very rapidly with that space. I'll mention that a little bit later as well. anything that has to do with advanced engineering practices, making sure that code is always ready, that it's always releasable, that continuous integration, continuous delivery is a fact of life. It's some of the things that definitely contributing into that evolution of connected business, as well as data. And data is, I cannot underestimate the importance of data in that sense. Given that we are shifting toward the connected experience where understanding, where knowledge, decisions are automated, data is the things that actually drives that evolution. In terms of the scale of the problem, if you will, it's significant, both from an economic perspective and also from a connected perspective. I mean, these numbers are very arguable. There is a bunch of different numbers out there that different entities are talking about. But we're talking tens of billions of devices in the next 10 years or less. We're talking hundreds of billions of devices in the 15-year or so period. We are talking about more than that, including the 10 billion humans that we will have in 2050 that are fully connected and are part of the overall technology ecosystem. In terms of the IoT play itself, and this is the way we're looking at it, obviously different companies look at it slightly differently, but we do believe that when IoT comes into play in an enterprise, it actually tests the enterprise. It tests the ability of the enterprise to evolve on all of these technology evolutions that are happening, but it also tests it in terms of individual capabilities that need to be brought to play to deliver on that premise. And again, data is super important. I cannot repeat that enough. Security is really important. Anything that has to do with mobile first and device capabilities is super important to that play. And obviously connectivity. I mean, amount of data in some of the industries, data that has been thrown literally out. I mean, things like digital exhaust notion, if you know what I mean from some of the industries. We're very real where today that data is being captured and analyzed and actually drives changes in the way businesses behave. This is a little bit of an eye chart. What I'm trying to say here is the following. The automation that is happening today, I mean, automation and technology in the engineering side is pervasive today, right? If we talk about continuous integration, continuous deployment. If we talk about automated testing, DevOps on all of the sort of scale of that, it's all about automation really, right? That automation seeps very rapidly into the enterprise. And what we're trying to depict here is the stages of evolution where we're quite in the beginning in that sense, but all of the cognitive analytics, deep analytics, semantic analysis, taxonomies that define the businesses will help businesses evolve toward a fully automated state where today the businesses are people optimized, meaning that decisions and processes are done by people. It will evolve into a stage where the actor is the system. The computer is the actor in the enterprise. People will drive the decision making, help computers make proper decision making, build proper models, develop proper algorithms. But at the end of the day, the system will be making the decision. And by the way, I mean, you can only imagine who will be making that happen. So this is you, really. I mean, you will be able to make that happen, developing the models, newer algorithms, better computers, and anything that's required for that state to take effect. Availability has been a pain for the enterprise space specifically, frankly, for the ISV space even for quite a long time. Today, first of all, the business is driven by the available systems, right? System is not available, you don't do business. Some enterprises do all of their business within like 60% of their revenues within one day a month, like some of the retailers, for instance, online retailers, right? Where like massive amount of transactions are happening at the end of the month. That availability is critical. That continuous availability of systems, meaning there is no downtime. No one is taking system down for upgrades. It just upgrades automatically, right? Anything that has to do with like canary upgrades and like rolling upgrades, blue-green, all of that methodologies are very fundamental to the way we deliver today, and it will increasingly so be applied to the enterprise space and has been quite integrated into the professional engineering, professional technology space for quite a while. So all this was a preview. I hope I didn't bore you too much with that. I want to talk about real stuff. The premise of the talk is step into the future. So I wanted to show a couple of examples, some of the work that we're doing in this space, sort of taking, putting it all together and making sure that we can actually deliver on the stuff that I'm saying up until now. So the year is 2001. Craig Venter with a group of researchers sequences the genome. First ever sequences of the human genome, sequencing of the human genome barely 16 years ago, 15 years ago. That project cost $100 million. It cost $100 million in 2001 to sequence one genome. In 2016, Craig Venter founded a company called Human Longevity Inc., where we are helping extensively with all of the engineering effectively end-to-end for their systems. The premise of the company is very simple. It's all about human longevity. It's all about making sure that we can, at some point in the very near future, prolong life, prolong happiness of people, prolong their ability to live longer, happier, better lives. Sounds crazy, right? I mean, sounds totally insane. The thing that's totally practical, and the reason why it's practical is because by taking that work on genome sequencing, 15 years ago, that was a single genome for $100 million. Today, today it's already sub $1,000 per genome, per sequencing. Tomorrow, literally, by the end of the year, we are dropping to less than $500 per sequencing. By the end of next year, we will be in $100 range. By the end of 2020, we'll be in cents, meaning that any one of us will come to a clinic, any clinic out there. They will sequence our genome, and using the applications that we're building for HLI, the system, that application, and really cool, so I mean, we're putting together gaming technologies in it just to make sure that it's actually talking to people, not just doctors. The system will be able to tell you what you actually need to do to live a better life. The premise, the long-term premise is for them to capture in the range of 100 million genome sequences and being able systemically to improve longevity. Systemically meaning that we will be able to analyze what does it mean for a particular group of people, what problems, what health problems, or whatever that is, that person might have, or group of people might have, and how very early on to be able to evolve that into something that will increase longevity beyond anything that we see today. And we're talking about, again, a range of maybe 20 years from now, 30 years from now. This is one application that we have been working on. When we were brought to the table for this initiative, and this is something that might be interesting for you guys as well, the skills that are required to build this is very broad. I mean, obviously, you see experience here, right? Experience is sort of the top of the glass, things that you see. But behind that, there is scientific analysis. There are actually scientists from our side as well as from HLI working on understanding how to map any genomic analysis. It's actually, they are not only doing genomic analysis, they're doing MRIs and stuff like that on a person to map all of the capabilities together. How do you put us all together? How do you create content around that where you can link like the MRI data, for instance, with the genome data? How can you make that applicable not just for today, but also for tomorrow, seeing how it can evolve. All of the backend development, I mean, we're integrating a ton of different medical equipment. Obviously, the applications themselves are very much integrating with all the variables, wearable technologies, and all of that. And this is a startup, so this is being done very quickly. They already have the prototypes. There is a lab in San Francisco that today a person can walk in. It's a little bit expensive at this point, but a person can walk in and make this complete sequencing, complete understanding of his health. They are understanding like cancer, for instance, from the very early stages, like a 2 millimeter range where they can actually and make recommendations of what needs to be done to either avoid that, remove that, and how to avoid that longer term. Automotive space, another area where we're focusing increasingly over the last several years. The reason for that is we frankly, I mean, EPAM was not really in core automotive back in maybe 6-7 years ago. The thing is that automotive is changing. Automotive is becoming digital first. And this is where we believe that we can bring extensive capabilities to play and to help these companies evolve into the connected space, into deep analytics, into very very effective experience for the drivers. And it's changing all over. It's not just the car. It's not just the car that is self-driving. It's actually quite a few other capabilities around it. It's how you experience the car. In fact, how you even go buy a car. I mean, do you really go into a dealership and buy a new car? Or can you do that using some augmented reality capabilities? Can you actually measure a car on yourself even before you own it, right? Sounds a little bit scary, I know. And then all of the experience in the car. And it's not just the driver, it's all of the experience in the car. It's your kids, whoever has kids. It's your spouses that are not necessarily driving, but they still want to have experiences. I mean, they still want to be connected. They still want, when moving between cars, you still want to have very deep personalization. When you or your other spouse or whatever is in that car, you want to personalize that car to that person. The other thing that is happening is, to the same degree, is in smart cities and how does transportation changes in smart cities. So this is projects that have been, and you guys in Mexico, the way I understand, have quite decent, good transportation systems, definitely better than the US one, from a busing perspective at least. But this is what it will look in the future. Bus is a screen. Bus experience inside the bus is a personalized screen. We know about the driver. We know how driver behaves. We know how he feels. We use galvanic skin response to understand stress level of a driver, and we are able to apply that to his routes or even substitute the driver if something happens from a health perspective. We can also remotely stop a bus and avoid an accident. We can connect that experience and route buses around traffic. That's not necessarily, the bus not necessarily has to stand in traffic. Specifically, when there's no one at the next stop, maybe the bus can go around. And we can know that there's no one at the next stop. We definitely know all the traffic conditions in the city these days. I mean, Google gives us that data and a bunch of other companies out there. So we can definitely take that data and apply it. We definitely know weather conditions. I'll speak about weather in a minute more extensively. We know that when, from an analytics perspective, we know that when it's raining, there are less people on bus stops. So maybe we can reduce the number of buses that are running. Or maybe we can actually let people call for the bus, like the Uber type application, right? Where a person can actually say, hey, I'm going to be in 5 minutes in this bus stop. Can you route any of the buses in the city to that bus stop so it can pick me up? There are a number of platforms out there that actually enable some of the capabilities. Obviously, a lot of still need to be glued together, but a number of companies that can actually give you all of that data from the car, from any moving object, in fact. I mean, it doesn't need to be a car. It can give all of the feedback to the driver. It can alert if something happens in advance, predictive maintenance, predictive analytics on the car. We can apply that very effectively these days. We can very effectively route that vehicle, a truck, for instance, that is hauling some goods, but potentially refrigerated goods that can spoil. And if we actually miss that, then the data is spoiled that we we missed to make that decision to send the truck into the service depot, right? We can tell that. We can order parts automatically. We don't need anyone for that. The truck can arrive there. The part will be waiting. We can apply augmented reality to help the technician fix the car in the fastest way possible. We can share the data that overall being aggregated from various, all of the vehicles in that region, and apply these technologies, apply the analytics, and tell the manufacturers, hey, in this particular region, because when we see that the weather is specifically like hot, hot weather or something like that, or increased humidity, these particular parts fail faster. So go ahead and actually fix the part or design a new part. Or we can tell the service bureau that, by the way, there is that other supplier for the part. Maybe you're better off taking that part for this region from that other supplier because they have a better part for that particular region. Weather. And by the way, all of that, everything, I hope you realize how it all connects to the compute capacity that I spoke before, how it connects all to the experience. None of this is possible without fast CPUs. I mean, it's just a fact of life. Obviously, none of that is also possible without you guys, without engineers, without people that can actually put this all together and connect all of the systems and leverage the technologies. Weather is an interesting component in all of that. Because weather contributes to many different things. Weather contributes to, obviously, economic component, right? There is, when a hurricane hits, if we can predict it fast enough, we can potentially optimize oil rigs, we can optimize the way people evacuate, we can optimize preparedness, we can actually tell stores that because of that weather event, you need to store more water. Because that's the only thing that is really being purchased at mass when something, when a flood happens, when a hurricane happens, and stores run out of water. So we can actually, if we can tell them 2 weeks in advance that a big weather event is coming, they can actually stock more water. And financial component of that is immense. But besides the financial component, there is obviously the human component. Hurricanes, tornadoes contribute quite significantly to death, right? To the fact that people are being caught in these events and do not successfully escape them. Specifically with tornadoes, I mean, hurricanes today we sort of more or less predict, although we proved in Sandy, for instance, in Hurricane Sandy, that the US prediction system is actually way behind. And we need much more capacity to being able to better predict the path of the hurricane and then prepare the cities on its path better for that. But what's more fundamentally important is when tornadoes hit, today with the current technology, we have only about 15 minutes, sometimes 20 minutes to alert people, and it's not enough. Actually, people, I mean, in 2018, 500 people died in the U.S. alone because of tornadoes, because there was like freak conditions for tornadoes. I mean, there were quite a few of them, and the alerting system did not work effectively. It did not alert people fast enough. So we need a better models, better algorithms, better systems, bigger computers, bigger scale. I mean, you see some of the information here. Professor De Benedictis talks about zettaflops at this point of a capacity that is required to fully predict weather all over planet Earth in a sort of, I think, 30 or 40 day period. We are quite far away from that at this point. I don't know if 2030 is the right number because this quote is from several years ago and there has been quite a lot of progress that is not necessarily linearly linked to Moore's law and stuff like that. So we might actually see it earlier, but we believe that weather predictions and overall integration of the weather data in the way companies operate, the way municipalities operate, the way countries operate can significantly change outcomes. on the lighter note, basic thing, detailing, right? Today, about 40% of online retail purchases of clothing being returned. It costs in the UK alone 60 billion pounds a year. There's quite a few companies out there that are trying to address the challenge. And it's typically done with relatively simple applications, right? There's a questionnaire, what do you look like, what do you weigh, what's your age? I mean, like specific questions about like maybe the compositions of your body and stuff like that. And then it would try to actually tell you that this piece of clothing is good for you and this piece of clothing is bad for you. We think that there is much more algorithmic play can be done in this space. And we can actually measure a person, measure meaning 3D map the person, understand exactly what the person looks like, and practically automatically tell the person whether something fits or something does not. But it can actually go a little bit further because like only 75% of returns, I mean, it's not only, quite a few, 75% of returns are done because something doesn't fit. Quite a lot of returns are done because something doesn't fit the wardrobe, right? Because everything is connected, because all of the purchases are done centrally, right? Specifically people that are very much connected to specific brands, to luxury brands especially, we actually know what person has in his wardrobe. So we can actually let him match the top to the bottom and see it before he actually buys it. And avoid all of that shipping, frustration because it doesn't fit or doesn't like, that person doesn't like the way he looks in that stuff, return, like going to the shipping company and actually returning it and all that stuff. This is a lighter application, nothing to do with weather. It doesn't kill people, but it's actually interesting where advanced algorithms can be applied for very rudimentary stuff that we do every day. Now, I want to talk about us, about you, about everyone that actually makes this happen. You've seen knowledge kills before. Our motto, our philosophy, the way we work, the way we engineer, the way we approach product development is speed kills. When you don't have it, obviously, it kills. It kills because, for a very simple reason, there are a bunch of other competitors out there for a particular business, for particular products, that want to do the same thing, and they want to take your market share. If you don't do it fast, if you don't release fast, if you don't do MVP, if you don't literally in real time push features out, it kills. Because the companies that don't do that, they run out of business because someone else takes that business from them. And this is enabled by you guys. I mean, this is an engineering challenge, nothing else. Yes, we sometimes blame others. We sometimes blame the product people in the organization. We blame the business for not giving us features on time or whatever that is. But it's really us who is enabling that evolution. And if we show that when they give us a feature requirement, we can actually push it out that same day, or, I mean, it takes time to code it, obviously, but within the coding interval, effectively, and testing interval that's supposed to be fully automated, the testing, not the coding, then we can actually show that them, they can trust us to providing these features fast enough so we can release them fast enough. And they can sort of get on the bandwagon of agile, not just from a technology perspective, but overall from an enterprise agility perspective. We have been very lucky in that regard. We have been focusing on a lot of the innovative stuff over the last 20 years. And it gave us a perspective. In terms of how we need to evolve ourselves. And I think it's applicable to quite broad audiences. Evolution, change, education are paramount. They're fundamental. Cannot be discounted whatsoever. Technologies change. There are quite a few cases out there where big companies that have been set in their ways, doing specific stuff, specific type of work, are running out of business because that work is not required anymore. So that change has to happen. Another component that is very important is work together. I know distributed teams is complex. We know that. I mean, we work in 25 countries, over four continents, pretty much spanning 24 time zones. You still can work together. We do that. I think it works great. I think we achieve quite a lot of results just because we work together, just because of all of the teams that are working together and making sure that deliverable is continuous, that one team left off, the other team takes over from a time zone perspective. And that enables us to very rapidly deliver value to our clients. And same for you. I'm just using our own examples for applying these methods, but I think it's applicable very broadly for everyone. Startup. Startup mentality cannot go away. No matter how big you are, it still has to be a startup mentality. That startup mentality doesn't mean that it's totally chaotic and random and all of that. It does not mean that. It means that we are focusing on the outcomes now, not tomorrow. We're not doing 6 month releases. We're not planning phases of whatever longevity they are. We are doing releases today, all the time, every day. New features, all of that stuff is a component of a startup. We're working as a team together. It's also a component of a startup, something that cannot be overthought. Innovation. Giving time to engineers to think outside their engagement is something that we have been focusing on from very early days. There are a number of companies out there that are very known for that, Google, for instance. We have been focusing on that for quite extensively for quite a few years at this point. We have built garages, and I encourage you to go to your companies and say, we need these innovation spaces, we need spaces to think, we need spaces to create, not just game rooms. Game rooms are important, but also spaces where you can innovate, spaces where you can work with your hands. And this is why, I mean, I love this. I love the hackathons that are being done here. I saw like number of events over the last couple of weeks where like totally amazing stuff is being done in a day, something like creating a car in one day, like creating a car from zero effectively to a full featured MVP of a car in one single day. This is the evolution. I'm not actually going to go too deep into that because I'm practically out of time. But this is just to underscore that things change all the time. Companies need to learn. Companies need to evolve. We started doing product engineering for product companies. We have done nothing else for the first decade. Nothing. It was only product engineering from product companies, forking for, we call it developers. So you have like a stage here that's called developers. We were helping developers develop products at scale. Then we realized that we actually can do a little bit more than that. We can take that capability and embed our knowledge of these products into the enterprise applications. And we started doing that, frankly, on the complex side. We have not done, at that point at least, we have not done simple customizations of SAP or something like that. We were brought in when no one else could solve the problem, when no one else could integrate that SAP platform for a particular company. We were brought in to solve that challenge. Then we realized several years ago, around our going public in 2012, we realized that we need to supplement that with digital capabilities, and digital capabilities, extensive digital capabilities, but not the way it's typically done, not like buying an agency and putting it aside and saying, hey, you need agency work, go there, they will create some images for you, some prototypes, maybe some HTML mockup or something like that, and then you actually come to us and we'll engineer a product for you. This is not the way we work. We realized very early on that teamwork that I was talking about previously has to exist across all of the capabilities, from strategy, not just digital strategy, but overall business strategy, all the way through engineering and continuous improvement. Has to be there all the time. Silos do not work. And then more recently, sort of even more further extending on that, being able to bring together clients and ecosystems of players to create a better value for our customers. This is pretty much what it is. And you have seen this. I mean, I hope you visited our booth. If you didn't, please do so. There's a lot of cool stuff going on there. Everything that I was talking before is really meant for this. We are focused on results and results relentlessly. We have been showing our customers over many years that we can solve the most complex challenge. And I'm sure you guys are trying to do the same or doing the same to a large extent. This is impossible without continuously changing ourselves. And this is impossible without you continuously changing yourself and making it better for the overall technology industry and for society in general. Thank you very much. I think I'm supposed to be taking questions. This looks scary. What do I do with this?
You throw it to the one you want to ask you a question.
Okay, I throw it to someone. Where? That's too far. Almost.
Hi there. Okay.
Hey.
It works. Well, at the beginning, you talk about the exponential growth in technology, and in the few years, like, it's been more like common know about artificial intelligence, and there's like kind of a debate about how this can, well, not can. It's going to change human life. Like people like Steve Wozniak says that computers will take care of us like we take care of a dog. And Stephen Hawking says that artificial intelligence will be the last great human invent. So I would like to know your opinion about this, being an expert in technology.
So I mentioned this before, and you're talking about the singularity question, effectively, where computers become more effective in inventing new stuff than humans. We're a little bit away from that. Artificial intelligence, deep learning, advanced analytics, cognitive intelligence, all of that stuff being practiced today in several places quite effectively. I think it's where the companies that there are a number of challenges actually in that space. If you think about the data sciences challenge overall, right, and just one application of that, we don't really today yet have the proper tools for that. We have the platforms to analyze data, that's given. But then if you think about any complex challenge that is happening, big oil companies, right, they have groups of scientists working on that stuff. You have a data lake, you're actually doing some analytics on that, deep learning and all that stuff, analyzing the data, very advanced algorithms, but you have one person working on that because you don't really have the tools for groups of people to work on that. There's some progresses in that space, obviously. This is an area that will need to be changed by humans, not by technology at this point, not by computers at this point. Being able to apply group analytics, letting groups of people work on complex data challenges effectively. This is the problem that exists today. We have actually done quite a lot of work in that space to building tools or whatever, accelerators to enable that. But totally important, I mean, absolutely something that will change the industry in quite a short period of time. Thanks for the question. As you see, I do not play American football.
Hello. I am really fascinated with all that you had to say about technological advances in the medical field. But aside that, you also talk about buses and like a couple of cool like gadgets that we could integrate into our lives to somehow make us well, have less problems and face less obstacles throughout the day and everything. So my question is, how exactly do you envision all of this fitting into our everyday life? Like in some sort of mobile device platform or some sort of smart city. How exactly do you feel that this would fit into human life and just come as naturally as possible for us to use?
So there are actually two answers to that, short term and a little bit longer term. Short term, so we have been fascinated with devices, specifically like around stress detection, for instance, or galvanic screen response and stuff. We have been doing research on that. Anything that has to do with neurosciences or like neurosensors and being able to read like whatever stuff from humans, we have been experimenting with that quite a lot. All of this is devices. I mean, it's something that you need to wear, something that is generally based on relatively available technologies today, like all of the AR, VR, I mean, all the goggles and stuff like that. It's still bulky though. And this is the second part of the question. I think, of the answer, I think over the next several years, I actually don't think it will go much further than that. And this is just to give you a context. So face recognition, right? Face recognition technologies, so video, real-time video recognition technologies improved over the last 2 years, I think about 1,000-fold. That will continue to improve. So for instance, when we were thinking about how do we measure stress of drivers in a car, 3 years ago, we were thinking about a wearable device. Today, we don't really, I mean, today maybe we still do, but in a year from now, we don't need to wear a device. We can have cameras in the car, and this is not just car, hospital, the same thing. Today, you have like a ton of stuff around the patient where like connected to the patient and all that stuff, extremely inconvenient, where you need to read all of the data, right, from a person. In literally years, we will have sufficiently accurate recognition systems that will be able in real time recognize a lot of the challenges that are associated with that, and then we would not need to wear it. Now, obviously, there will be platforms behind that. I mean, like smartphones are not going away for a near term, right? I mean, we can foresee embedding these capabilities within the humans within maybe 5-year period or start of that. I mean, we're seeing that with Google Glass, for instance, right, where it's still a wearable, but it's already much closer to your eye than a device. So that will evolve as well quite extensively. Thanks for the question. Anyone? Any questions over there? Oops, sorry about that. Again, not American football.
What is EPAM doing in terms of making technology more accessible, not only to more people, but to poor people? Sometimes technology, specifically things that have to do with health, are only accessible for those who can pay for it. What kind of projects is EPAM doing in this respect?
Great question, thank you. The HLI story that you saw effectively an iPad application with a simulated person. This was actually Craig Venter himself, simulated Craig Venter. We started applying gaming to the enterprise applications several years ago. We see extensive impact from that. And this is sort of making it very close to the human, right? I mean, making this experience very rich, very accessible, specifically to the younger generation, right? This is all about democratization. I mean, this is the notion. We specifically talk about democratization of technology in a lot of our work that we're doing internally and with clients. And this is one of the areas. Another area is sort of open source, right? Democratization of the core technology, of the backbone of technology. Right, extensive contributions to that over the years. We have been doing that for very early on. We have been working with a number of great companies for developing, for instance, big data technologies. We have EPAM has on staff number of people that were at the cornerstone of the Big Tap project, for instance, literally people that contributed like extensive amount of code into that. So that's another sort of from a backend perspective. From an experience perspective, making it accessible, the notion of hybrid teams, teams that actually can bring together digital strategists, experienced people with engineers, making sure that the experience is both attractive and usable, but also very real and very attainable in a very short period of time. This is something that we also extensively focus on. You see, I'm not even trusted to throw the thing anymore. Any other questions? There were a lot of questions from that side. Any questions from here? I will not throw. I will actually ask someone to pass it so it doesn't kill anyone.
How can your company to be secure that the data in the internet is correct, is not false, because you use that data for your apply, or I don't know?
Great question, thank you. I will actually counter that with another question. Do any of you think that when data is stored like internally within the enterprise, I mean, it's a question of cloud security, right? That it's secure just on the basis of being stored within the enterprise. We mulled quite extensively on the security questions around the cloud simply because we have been doing cloud software as a service platforms for, I mean, they were not even called software as a service at that point, but I was building a company that I was working with even before EPAM. EPAM was helping with that as well. In 2001, we were building the first software as a service platform in the financial space. Sort of before cloud was known as cloud, right? So we mulled back then about the security, data security challenges. In fact, if you look at news over the past year and a half, all the data, or not all, but quite a few of the big cases of data losses, Home Depot, for instance, right? All the data was internal. It was all within the enterprise. It was all residing in either traditional relational databases or like Hadoop clusters, and it was still stolen. Because you cannot rely on perimeter security for security. It's not security. It's just a false notion of security that you're creating for yourself and actually doing a huge disfavor for that. So we have been extensively working on the, again, we have been contributing to the big data platforms for years at this point, and extensively focusing on making sure that we can embed secure capabilities within the platforms, regardless where they're deployed. I mean, it's totally irrelevant there you deploy it in the enterprise or in the cloud. I mean, totally irrelevant. Making sure that encryption is in place, at rest and in transit, that we can actually seed data. We can obfuscate data when needed. All of these capabilities must be in place, specifically when we're talking about distributed applications, when we're talking about very complex distributed data platforms. All that has to be in place to make sure the data is secure. Perimeter does not work for that. Thanks for the question. Great question. So I think we are done. I'm out of time, do we understand, right? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, everyone. Again, thanks for the organizers for putting this together. Thank you.